Okay, good morning, everyone. So today, for the first tutorial, what we are going to introduce is automatic entity recognition typing for massive text corpora. So the speakers, actually Xiang is here. He is currently our PhD candidate at UIC. Unfortunately, Ahmed, El-Kishky, and Wang, these two, cannot be here. El-Kishky currently is a PhD student at UIC, and Wang, he just graduated from UIC last year. He joined Microsoft Research in Redmond, so he is still somehow research tied with us. I'm Jiawei Han. I'm a professor in UIC. So for this tutorial, essentially, is we discuss how to use phrase mining and network mining to handle large text corpora. And I know we have very limited space. So the first thing is, if you you know the space is very limited, likely we will be a little tight. So anybody, if you you see other people come, you just you have a space nearby, just make sure you give enough room for other people to attend. Another thing is even the water, you probably can see is in the front instead of the back. Feel free, you really feel thirsty, you can walk up, you can just fetch water. As long as you don't make too much noise, it won't affect other people, it should be fine, okay? So we will have a break in the middle. I think we somehow around 10 to 10:30, we will have a break. I think it's a 30-minute break. So the tutorial start 9 to around 10:30 will break for 30 minutes. Then we start from 11 to 12:30. So that's a general schedule. Okay, so without further introduction, we just ask Xiang to give the general introduction. Okay.
Thanks. Thanks for having me here. I'm Xiang Ren. I'm a PhD candidate at UIUC. So my research interest is kind of still changing from doing the recommendation system and some kind of user behavioral study to currently doing more on the text mining aspects, including entity extraction, relation extraction, and different text modeling. So today's topic, we kind of want to give us a rough idea about when you're having a max text corpora and you want to extract some entities from them to assist different kinds of applications. So what is the best methods you can choose under different assumptions of the corpora? So the take-home message after this tutorial will be you'll be somehow clear about with the current corpora on hand, what is the best approach you can be trying instead of just blindly try different methods. So the outline of our tutorial, we will first introduce the problem of the entity recognition and typing, as well as the background and motivation of doing this. And then we will majorly focus on the two key components of this problem, of the problem solution, which is the recognizing the entities out of the text. We'll give the overview of the state-of-the-art methods, as well as the proposed phrase mining approaches from our aspect. And also, the second component is the entity typing part, also overview the state-of-the-art methods and introduce a network mining approach for doing this in a very scalable way. And finally, we will conclude with some still unsolved research issues and some interesting future directions to go. So people keep trying to find effective and efficient way to understand the text corpora. So they start with breaking down the text corpora into a bunch of words or bag of words and calculate the statistic of different words to somehow have a basic idea about the corpora. And then they also try doing topic modeling, trying to summarize the topics and visualize the topics to help people grab a quick understanding of the text corpora. But think about from human aspects. So usually we will first identify the entities in the text corpora. we figure out the types of the entity, we figure out the relations between the entity, and then we figure out the entire story of the documents and the corpus. This is very nature of fraud. So suppose we can automatically extract the entities out of the text corpus. There's a lot of interesting applications starting from here. For example, a very straightforward one is you simply link these entities to the knowledge space, like Freebase, Wikipedia, Yago, and so on. And you will dive deeper into those knowledge base to figure out more about the entities and figure out the entire story. Another interesting direction with the recognized entities is to do some structure analysis over the massive text corpus. So think about doing entity recognition and typing of a corpus can become projecting the text corpus into a multi-dimensional table where each column actually corresponding to different types of entities and different relations between the entities. So with such table, you can easily do a lot of like database applications and multi-dimensional analytics things on the table. For example, on the news, you can easily extract the location, organization, and person. And then you can you can print out the charts and print out the trends of the news stories. On the scientific publications, you already have some structures like authors and venues associated with each paper. But moreover, you can extract like technique and application concepts out of the paper body. And then trying to say, let's say, compare it, what the two papers are doing, whether they are proposing something novel compared to each other or where they are sharing many techniques and application. So you can do structured database query or even more the information network analysis. Suppose you can construct a very nice network out of the DBLP bibliography datasets. And using the information analysis techniques, you can answer a lot of interesting questions, such as finding the leading researchers on the web search domain by doing the ranking in terms of the author nodes in the network. Or you can even figure out how the field of data mining is emerged during the past 10 years by doing the network evolution analysis and so on. So let's take a closer look at the problem definition. So entity recognition and typing actually consists of two parts. The first one, you need to identify dimensions of the entity out of the text, which means you need to find out the token spans of entity dimensions. And the next stage will be you want to classify these identified entities into the predefined categories. For example, if you predefine the person and location for the news corpus, or you predefine protein and cell for the medical corpus. But the task is really challenging. Why is that? You have many issues here. For example, many entities will share the same surface names. When you talk about a Spartan of Washington State University, or you talk about the Washington State, or talk about the US government, or the Washington DC, the city, all of this can be referred as Washington in the text. This is the non-ambiguity problem. And one entity actually will have many surface names. We can call them the nicknames, some atypical names, and so on. And also, an entity can associate with multiple types. You have to understand, under certain context, what is the exact type it is referring. Like for Barack Obama, under certain context, it can be referred as a US congressman or just a person or US president. There are different levels of types here. So we call them type ambiguity. And furthermore, the entity will have pretty much grammatical informal names like in and out. It's totally, from English grammar, it's kind of new things. So we identify majorly two scenarios when we're doing the entity recognition and typing task. The first one, we call them the online version, is that you're assuming that the document or the text fragment is coming like a sequence, one by one. And you need to perform the entity recognition and typing module in an online manner. For example, you have some web API providing this entity recognition typing service, or you have some query search intent need to identify and you need to do the entity recognition as a primitive step, or you need to do the question answering in an online manner. The second one, which has a vast majority of applications, is taking the large test corpus as a batch, as the input. And we want to, let's say, taking out the text corpus from different data sources, like from different news agencies, and collectively find out the entity names and their types in a batch manner. So this scenario actually have a lot of interesting applications. From the business intelligence aspects, let's say if you analyze the news corpus on the politics topics, you can figure out the top 10 active politicians regarding the healthcare issues, which you can find out Barack Obama actually is one of them. And you can figure out the influential high-tech companies from Silicon Valley by analyzing the tech company related text materials. Or if you look from the aspects of knowledge-based completion angle, you actually have a lot of more data to consider, from web pages to different enterprise data to different data from the verticals like Yelp and so on. And entity recognition typing actually serves as a primitive step to identify these newly merged entities from the dynamic text corpus. So the focus of this tutorial, starting from here, is about the large corpus. Since we have a lot of such massive test corpus existing, and we have a lot of applications from the second scenario. But then, actually, the techniques we're gonna introduce and propose for this large text corpus will be pretty different from each other, depending on the characteristics of the text corpus. Thinking about the first aspect to distinguish them is by the domains these text corpus are coming from. It could come from general domains like news, politician news, and so on, or a specific domain like some enterprise data or just scientific publications. So the main assumptions different in this angle is that how many labeled data you have regarding these test corpus. If it's from general domain, you actually have pretty much tagged data sets from a lot of name entity recognition share tasks. These data sets, most of them actually come from news, wires data, or let's say some easy to access data, and they are pretty general. And if you can just train the a classifier based on these data sets, you actually can has pretty good performance on a general domain text corpus. But once you narrow down the scope to a specific domain, like papers from computer science, you actually found out you have no access to label data. You have to hire people, do crowdsourcing. You have to spend a lot of things to get the label data and make those traditional methods work well. Another aspect to distinguish them is how formal is the text. Still, we use the example of news, which have pretty formal English grammar, versus microblogs, tweets, reviews. People can use irregular grammars. They can just try to use any kinds of capitalization or punctuation as they want, making the traditional method pretty perform pretty poor in this scenario. So these two scenarios actually will guide us to introduce different methods regarding the two key components, which is the entity recognition and typing. So let me pass the entity recognition part to my advisor, Jiawei.
Okay. Yeah, so anybody standing there, if you want, there's one empty seat here. Okay, you can come down, you can take a seat here before we start. Okay. Yeah, the room is a little small, but you know, we have to live with it. Okay. So as Xiang just mentioned, our major task is we got a lots of unstructured data, like especially text data. We want to turn the unstructured massive text data into knowledge, which is not easy at all. And in the last several years, we have been dealing with this unstructured data. We essentially developed two essential technologies. Okay, one is entity recognition. That means we actually try to recognize from the very large text corpora. Okay, we try to recognize each entity with the maximum we can get the precision and the recall. Simply says, if they are a good entity, we try to extract them. Okay, then the second one we want to do is typing. That means we grab Washington. Okay, based on the context, whether Washington is a person, is a state, is a capital, or even is a sport team. Okay, so that both of them actually is not easy. Okay, so we try to accomplish these two tasks. Then we try to turn the massive unstructured data into structured knowledge. Okay. That's the general goal. And this one, mainly I have two PhD students who have made a really good progress, published their papers in both this year's SIGMOD 2015 and VRDB 2015. So my emphasis will be on these two papers. Of course, I will give you a general overview. Okay. And then for entity typing, this part essentially is Xiang Ren. He's going to he already just published one paper in this conference, which called class type. He's going to focus on this new technology, how to do entity recognition typing. Okay, I myself actually just gave a keynote speech a week ago, in Beijing in ACL conference, which is Computational Linguistic Conference. That's NLP, Natural Language Processing Conference. But as everybody knows, I'm a more data mining person instead of an NLP person. So my knowledge on NLP is still limited, okay? Actually, this part was done, all the slides, this part was, you know, done by my PhD student, Ahmed. Unfortunately, he could not attend this conference. He actually will go to VRDB in Hawaii to present his work. But anyway, I'm going to try my best. Feel free, you know, if I got any mistakes, you know, you have to excuse me instead of excuse Ahmed. Okay. But anyway, you get anything you are not familiar with, so you have doubts, feel free to raise questions. Okay. So the first thing we want to do is on this entity mention detection. That means if we look at a sentence like this, okay, we should recognize like Barack Obama as an entity, Washington DC as entity, President Obama as entity, then Michelle as entity, okay? So if we can look at those entities, some a single word like Michelle, some actually it's a multiple word like Barack Obama or President Obama. Those are the things we try to recognize. You can say these multiple ones are bigrams or even trigrams, or you can say they are phrases. Okay. So our phrase mining essentially trying to recognize those tokens, and we grab them, say these are the single entities, we'll pass it to Xiang. Xiang will recognize like Barack Obama is a person. Washington DC actually is a city or something like this, okay? So, but it's a tough task because of a human, you have knowledge, okay? You have the thinking the machines are almost like a Martians. They came from Mars. They know nothing about the word, nothing about English. But it's essentially you still try to recognize these are good entities, okay? So that means we want to recognize the names of people, organization, locations, like even food or concepts, you know, recognize this thing. In the past, actually there were lots of work in natural language processing, we call NLP. They have studied this one extensively, okay? They essentially using some kind of grammatical structures of the sentence, like you do parsing, okay, you do name entity recognition. So they have done a lot of work. Okay, we are going to overview their work. In the meantime, we are not 100% confined to their work. We actually, as a data miner, you always want to develop a new data mining technology to see whether it can do better. Okay, so that's the general idea why we want to do entity name detection. Okay, we first go back to the early days of NLP, the natural language processing. I cannot say it's 100% early days. Even now, they have been working on this substantially. Okay, the first thing they do is full sentence parsing. What is full sentence parsing? Is they take the raw text sentences, sets of strings. Okay, what they do is they do full text parsing. They want to construct the full parse trees like this. You get sentence, you get noun phrase, verb phrase. Then you get into determinant, you get noun or something. You finally get a sentence fully parsed. Okay, but actually, it is not an easy job because you know this parsing. Potentially there are lots of ambiguity. You can construct lots of different trees. Okay, just give a simple example. Like classically, NLP people use time flies like an arrow. Okay, something like this. You can based on semantic, can say time is an entity, fly is a verb or something. Then you can even say time flies actually is a verb, is an entity, it's a noun phrase. Okay, of course it gets something ridiculous, but grammatically they are correct, right? So to get this parsing, essentially is you parse segments, input text, sentence into parse trees. Usually you get noun phrase, indicated entity mentioned candidates. Then you get a verb, you get other noun phrases. Okay, those are usually the typical way to do it. But even that, in the parsing or semantic parsing in NLP, is still an active research topic. Okay, why? Because you may get low accuracy, and also there are lots of new media like Yelp, tweets. Like in China, they also have some kind of new media. But the problem is, they write down something not grammatically all correct. Okay, so people like 120, characters, you write in a very rough way. Okay, grammarly may not write. Okay, so that you try to get this tree, you get a real problem. Okay, and another thing is, it is pretty expensive. You try to get all these trees because there are so many different possibilities. You compute and compare them. It could be quite slow. Okay. So there are problems for these methods. Then we just get a little analysis on this full parsing. Is the parsing may yield low accuracy, okay? And parsing requires non-trivial training data. A lot of training data are manually curated, means you have to get the experts label those things. You know, you finally take those labels putting in. Just give you a simple example. We work with one NLP professor, Heng Ji. She actually gave us the trained, curated 2010 New York Times, those news data. Okay, that essentially you get 500 documents curated carefully by NLP experts or some good experts of the domain. Okay, then you can use this one. You parse and label all those other documents in 2010 New York Times. But when we work on that, it was 2014 already. Okay, we say, could you give us 2014? Okay, New York Times. They say no. This one doesn't work for 2014. 2014, you have again another 500 documents. You curate them. We think it's kind of big headache because you think about things that keep changing, right? You do this curation, it's not quite scalable. Okay. Then the parsing also may adapt poorly to new domains. Like you get different things like tweets, Yelp. Even you go to different scientific domains, like you go to medical domain, or you go to physics, chemistry. They could be completely different. Your curated New York Times will not work. So that's another serious problem. Then the fourth problem is the parsing computationally is very slow, and you get a web scale. You do not want to do fully parsing every sentence on the web. Okay, so there must be some method we may overcome this full parsing. Okay, so in principle, we will not go to the deep full parsing. We want to do something a little shallow. But it works, okay. So With that, we introduce more like on the name entity recognition, not on the full parsing. We actually will review you three major methods. One called supervised, semi-supervised entity dimension detection. The second one is completely unsupervised entity dimension detection. The third one is something in the middle of the two, is we use weakly and distantly supervised mention detection, okay? You may wonder, you know, why we have to get the supervised, weakly supervised, because you get semi-supervised, now you get weakly and distantly supervised. What does this mean, okay? While we get inside, you probably see a little more clearly, but you can see is weakly and distantly supervised simply says you don't even bother to mark 2010 New York Times, okay? You want something very weak, I mean, simply says you, if you have some label in general, you can label them, or distantly supervised means you can give me something like a Freebase or Wikipedia, okay? And then we use this kind of a knowledge base to do supervision, then we can work on other things, like we do not even mark this 2010 New York Times, we want to make it work. Okay, so the same this supervised, you still need to mark those things. Okay, but the unsupervised means that there's nobody doing anything. Okay, you just but we will see. You know, some interesting thing may come out. Okay, so then for this entity dimension detection, that whole pipeline is you got raw cap corpus. Okay, then you try to find the tokens. Like we call this tokenization. These tokens may not be very hard for like English because it's already that you get some language like Chinese actually try to get token, it's not easy, right? And you can get a part of speech tagging, okay? Then you can have whether they are verb, they are active, noun, you know, like those things. And then you may get a candidate detection, like those phrases, like United States, Red Cross, US government. You may get those things, okay? Those things we call phrase mining. Of course, some phrase may be just single word, like Louisiana, okay? Now we first look at the non-phrase chunking. That means instead of doing full text parsing, we go back a little. We say we know the full text parsing is too expensive, okay? Now we go in down to a little lower goal is non-phrase chunking. Essentially this, okay? For example, if you see the sentence, we saw the yellow dog. Okay, so how could you get this? I just remind everyone. Okay, so you don't need to take pictures on this. Of course, you can if you like. The whole slice is on the web. You can download it. Okay, you go to the KDD, you know, the tutorial page. There's a button. There's a PDF and PPT. We publish everything. Okay, of course. The most recent version, we did a minor change. The most recent version may not be very consistent with this one. After this tutorial, we're going to load a very, very last version up to the web. If you want to print it, you better wait until you finish the tutorial rather than, you know, you print it now. Okay. So one thing we do this is, you can see, is you apply tokenization part of speech tagging to those sentences. You know this is a preposition, this is a verb, this is a determinant, you get adjective and noun, okay? Then what our task is, we can say this part is a noun phrase, this is a verb, the other part, the whole thing is a noun phrase, okay? So that we call noun phrase chunking. That means you get the yellow dog, this whole thing is a noun phrase, okay? But of course we have to know not all the phrases useful for entity dimension. I mean, some may not be very, very useful, but you know, some other signals, in addition to part of speech tagging, could be helpful. But that one later, I think, especially we get into typing. Xiang is going to discuss more detail on this one. Another thing is noun chunks often smaller than the noun phrases. Okay. That simply says sometimes the noun phrases could be quite big. You get quite a few n-grams. For example, if you say Dallas, that's an airport, international airport, it could be pretty long, okay? But Dallas itself could be a phrase, right? And you know, international airport could be another phrase. But getting together is one phrase because the chunk can partition into several, but these several can be combined into a big meaningful one. It could be a bigger noun phrase, okay? Like U.S. President Barack Obama, okay? That's why it's a bigger, but it's one noun phrase, okay? So then we look at the first method, supervised, semi-supervised entity dimension. Then we are going to discuss B and C a little more extensively because B actually was worked out by Ahmed. He published his paper in VRDB 2015. We are focusing on this one. And C actually was worked out by Jialu Liu. Of course, Xiang is one of the co-authors. It's a weakly and distantly supervised motion detection. So these two, even we are not discussing now, but we were focused on this too, probably in this part of the tutorial. Okay, I first mentioned this supervised entity dimension detection. Why you want to supervise? Everybody knows supervision actually is very useful. You do want to. Sometimes you do want to mark them. Okay, that's typically why NLP people they want to mark them. They want to curate them. Okay. And the training data, usually it is more expensive than POS tagging, but less so than the full parsing. That means you think of the full parsing, you get a full tree. Sometimes it's ambiguous, sometimes it's expensive, we know that. But if you add a little supervision, but you are not aimed for full parsing, you still can get very good, you know, the entity recognition because POS tagging, just to give you, you know, a little information. If you put a little supervision, it will help, okay? Then the training data, usually you get a chunk of data can be used for training like this. If you can recognize these several things, you do some training, you will get a better result, okay? So essentially for non-phrase chunking, you can see a lot of NLP people, they use this IOB representation. What is IOB? I means inside. Just give you a simple example, okay? So you can see the yellow dot, okay? This B means the beginning. Beginning, that means you start with the noun phrase. This D actually is a determinant, but it's the beginning of this noun phrase, okay? Then the subsequent one is right inside this noun phrase. You call I noun phrase. I means inside, okay? So you can see this even is adjective, but it's inside of this noun phrase. The dog is also inside of this noun phrase. So these IOB, O means outside. O actually is a verb. It's outside of this noun phrase. So you probably can see like here, this one is a we. This is the beginning of the noun phrase. But then here you immediately see the saw. This one actually is a verb, okay? Then you see this is outside of noun phrase, simply says, once you see this, you know this one, even if it's just beginning, this one is a noun phrase, okay? Then here you can see the yellow dog. You have a beginning, then you have inside, and then you have full stop, okay? In that sense, this whole thing is a noun phrase, okay? So that's the one in NLP, they use this inside, outside, beginning as a marker. Then you can mark this, you can recognize it, okay? Now, if you have labor data, you give some example, you labor them, then you can use MP chunker as a classifier. That means you can build a model, okay? Simply says, you use this IOB representation. Every word is either I, is O, or B, you labor them. Once you label them, you will use this one as a training data so you can build a classification model, okay? The classification model, you can use many different methods like naive Bayes, like, you know, like more sophisticated, like, you know, support vector machine, hidden Markov model. You can use lots of different ways to build it. But anyway, the training data contains IOB label.
Okay.
With this label, you try to construct a model. Later, you can learn other things. Okay. So that means you for unigram chunking is you take every word as a unigram. Okay. So you take this, you can get a unigram chunking. Essentially, is giving each word as a part of speech stacking. You can directly classify every word to IOB chunk. So this essentially is every word you get a most likely IOB tag. Using this method, using training, you actually get this IOB accuracy can reach 93%. The precision and the recall is not bad. The whole F1 is something like 83%. Okay, so that's just a simple classification method using this IOB label. Okay. But of course, unigram sometimes may not reach the best accuracy. So what about you get a little higher order chunker? Okay, a little higher order chunker. If here is you use more like a bigram, you can think in this way: is this bigram chunker is not only look at the one in the front, you look at the two in the front. Okay, so you can see if you want to recognize this word, you look at n minus 2, n minus 1, you look at these two, okay? You get two DACs, you try to decide this one, okay? Then if you use the window a little bigger, you just use bigram instead of unigram, actually you enhance the accuracy, precision, recall, and F1, okay? If you compare the previous one, okay, let me see, we can go back. The previous one, F1 is 83%. If you use bigram, this model, you use a higher order, okay, you can see this one becomes 85%. That means you do, if you use a little, of course, the processing a little more expensive, but you get a better accuracy, okay, get a better F1, okay. So that's, then for classification methods, okay, you can use some classical non-sequential classifiers. For example, you can use support vector machine, ensemble, naive base, or logistic regression. Essentially, the general idea is you try to find those maximum margin. You can separate the positive and negative one. Then you use random forest. You just vote or ensemble based on all the different trees. So whatever you use, this classifier will enhance. You use IOB tag. You enhance your accuracy or your quality of the phrase extraction. Okay, for example, you use support vector machine. You can use forward parsing, backward parsing. You can think the word goes in this direction in the sentence. You have, if you recognize the ice one, you can look at two in the front, or even you look at two at the end. So your total may have more tags. I think this one should be I plus 2. Okay, sorry about this. We can make this correction afterwards. But anyway, you use a little, you total can use 8, these support vector, okay, because you can use 2 in the front, 2 at the end. So use this to do the chunking. You can get a better result, okay. And also you can use multiple models. You can use contextual language model, you can use chunking model, you can use a lexical probability, you can use the combination of all these three, but I will not get into very detail. The lexical probability essentially is you look at the word frequency, tag frequency, word per tag frequency, you use these additional signals. Then you can combine them, okay. This essentially is using jointed tagging and chunking with those bigram. You can further improve the accuracy. From the modeling wise, you can think is you use concatenation of lexical tags, syntactic units, and also transition probabilities and lexical probabilities. You use all those signals. You try to enhance from part of speech stacking to final entity recognition, okay? But this actually involved lots of NLP study. They actually combined this using dynamic programming. Essentially, a lot of people using Viterbi algorithm. But this is quite involved. There are several research papers we put at the end, but I will not get into very detail on this process. But you know, the general philosophy is you try to use all the signals, all the different language models, you construct them. Then you use dynamic programming, you try to optimize, select the very best method. Okay, so that's the general idea. But it's quite involved. There's still active research along this line, but I'm not going to get into very detail. But you know, the even you do tagging, there are lots of tricks to improve the, you know, the further classification accuracy to get better entities. Okay. And there's another method called maximum entropy classifier. Okay. It simply says you want to use the external features like current word, part of speech tagging of the current word, surrounding words, and part of speech tagging of surrounding words. Using all those signals, then you try to use maximum, calculate their maximum entropy, then you try to find the largest entropy using this formula. Okay. But I will not get into this maximum entropy in a very detail, but what I can tell you is if you use maximum entropy, okay, your max, your F measure can be further improved. Remember, we just said you get a bigram model, you get into F measure is 85. Now you get 85.3. But if you further add a boosting, add a voltage perception, you can further improve the F1 measure, okay? So that's the general idea is you try to use the state-of-art max entropy tagging, then you to generate this top end segmentation, and you use boosting or use voltage perception, those methods to re-rank those segments. You can get a further improved F measure, okay? But you know, that one also involved lots of research papers in NLP. I'm not going to get into very detail. Okay. Then there's another method is to use sequential data model. The sequential data model essentially is you look at this one in the process like a Markov chain process. That means you actually use those Markov hidden Markov model, Markov chain model, to think about it, everyone going one by one, they fall in certain sequence, they go down to different states. Based on this, you try to analyze those hidden states to explain your observation, okay? So this is a sequential Markov model, it's still training, but you take care more on the sequence, okay? So the hidden Markov model for motion detection, essentially you can think about it this. For every current state, you want to think there's a probability from the previous state to go down to this state. Okay, so this is one probability. Another one is you based on the observation, you will say from this state, you should what's a probability you get current observation. Okay, then use this tool, you try to derive based on the Markov assumption and a stationary, assumption and output independence assumption. You use those Markov chain model, you try to say this one is a beginning, this one is right in the middle, like the cat. You say this actually is an entity, okay? And this one is outside, but this is the beginning, this is another one, okay? So then you can recognize the entities and the outside entities serve as separator, okay? So. But when you calculate this one, you based on, you know, now you have this beginning, what's the chance you get this one's inside model? You can turn this probability calculation into the conditional probability under this beginning, what's the chance, if this is a beginning tag, what's the chance you get the, okay? And then with this, what's the chance you get I? You get the inside of this. Noun phrase, okay. Using this hidden Markov model, you actually can see, this is another paper, they use different tasks. you probably can see if you only use one, you get a 71%, you get 76 of F1. We will probably only look at the F1. But if you use two, you substantially jump up. Okay, that simply says you use more states, you get more benefit. If it was three states or even four states, you actually get even higher F1. Simply says you use hidden Markov model, use more previous states, you get a better F1. Okay, but this hidden Markov model also has its limitation. Okay, essentially is you calculate the maximum likelihood, but you do not consider some non-independent observation variables. Okay. Sometimes people may give you additional signals. You may not consider this. So to address such limitation, actually people developed a method essentially is you use observation, instead of thinking this is a probability, joint probability of this observation and the state, you actually think it's a conditional discriminative probability. Under this observation, what's the chance to get this state? Then you can use a lot of features like words, line length, grammar, and contextual. Use these as a conditional probability, you derive better state. Okay, so use this discriminative conditional probability, you derive better ones, then you just use this joint probability distribution. Okay, so that means you actually, based on this idea, people work out maximum entropy Markov model. That essentially is, instead of using hidden Markov model, you just go straight this way. You can see from t minus one to t, then you go down to this observation. Instead of using this model, you can use conditional maximum entropy Markov model. That means you think these two both feed into this current state. So you got into the conditional probability or discriminative probability instead of getting this strictly hidden Markov model. Okay. So using this, actually people show if you use, this is a statalist Markov, this maximum entropy Markov model. Okay. Then you use token, use feature, you use embedded all these maximum entropy. You probably can see you get a precision recall, and this is a co-occurrence agreement, all these you get higher. Okay, so that's about sequential model. Okay, and another method using conditional random fields. Okay, that one essentially is you adding, you train those conditional random fields. You further try to improve the accuracy, but I will not get into very detail. What you can see is there are lots of studies on using these conditional random fields. You get a pretty high F score. You look at these consider the you use conditional random fields. You can reach a pretty high F score compared to the previous methods. So in the application, people actually further use domain text. Domain text means you get into, say, biomedical literature. Instead of just using the previous methods, use lots of domain knowledge, like a kidney, muscle, blood, you use all these, because the biomedical people, they give you a lot of mesh terms or some other labels. These labels they think is their dictionary or their state of art. They label this, then you mark them, this is an organ or this is a tissue. If you mark this, you use this knowledge, you can further improve. That means you use domain knowledge. Actually, it's not just confined to medical. Any domain, for example, you go to NASA or go to Boeing, they have aviation. They have lots of terms on aviation. They give you a huge dictionary. So you just rely on that. You know, integrate together with your entity, you know, all these things, you can get better entity recognition. Okay, so that's usually, once you have this signal, you should use it. Okay. So that's essentially, you can develop a semi-Markov conditional random field. I probably will not get into the very detail, but you can see as it uses, you can further improve. You can use more and more training data. You can further improve the tagging, you know, all these. Okay. And if you can further explore the relation detection, that means not just look at the entity. You look at the sentence, for example, you just look at this one. Okay. This one said, the tire maker still employs 1,400. Okay. If you do not know, because this 1,400 can mean anything, right? You do not even know what it is. But if you look at this tire maker, and especially look at the relationship called employees, okay? By human, you probably know. These employees means these 1,400 are actually person, are employees, right? Otherwise, why is that the employees 1,400? That means this relational signal is very important to recognize the entity here. That is a very important assumption, because you just think about this, just based on name entity tagging or something, this 1,400, you have no way to even know what it is. Okay. But if you got a relation like this employees, and then you immediately see this 1,400, originally, you know, you do not know what it is, the type is person will substantially increase just because of this employees. Okay. That one, actually, Xiang is going to discuss how he can find the types, okay, based on this relationship. That means you use this relation, you try to get tag, and this is very powerful. Okay, but I'm not going to discuss this one in this part. The next part, actually, Xiang is going to discuss in detail on how to explore this relationship to recognize the entity types. Okay. But if you see, you use joint entity extraction, you do incremental work, you can substantially increase the entity quality. Okay. But I think Xiang is going to discuss more on how to do the typing. I'm not going to discuss this one in more detail. Now we come down to more exciting part. These two actually are the one we think is more exciting. One is unsupervised entity matching, another is weakly and distantly supervised. Okay. The unsupervised one basically say, you usually find part of speech tagging usually is less expensive, comparing to, you know, to get a full parsing. Okay, and also it generates much better to, for example, to new domain like tweets. The training data may not be available at all, but you can use based on part of speech tagging. If you can do, then you can substantially enhance this. Okay, that means instead of you try to find a full parsing tree, which is very hard, what we got is very local. Our grammar could be very simple, like you have determinant, or this question mark means yes or no. That means sometimes you may not have determinant. But you may have more than one adjective. You get noun. You get a noun chunking pattern like this. Okay, for example, like this. If you don't have the parse, you see there's the big yellow dog. These two both are adjective. You get this. This is actually is a noun phrase. You can chunk them. You probably can see you can get more pattern like this one is the initial one. You actually can get other pattern, like you get this one have a multiple this, or this one have multiple noun, or you get multiple noun phrases. Okay, and you can improve the chunking. Now we look at how we can use the whole corpus information to do this. Actually, our method is somehow very different from the typical NLP method. The typical NLP method is taking, say, one or few documents. You try to recognize it. Our major philosophy is we take a lot of documents. Okay, that means you take the whole corpus. the philosophy is use this collective one, you actually make use of their redundancy. Interesting. I quite often, actually, people cannot understand what's the difference between one document versus the whole corpus. I quite often give an example. Suppose you were captured by, say, Taliban, okay? They put you down into a cell. They give you, say, their Arabic newspaper. Suppose you know nothing about Arabic. The first day you read it, it doesn't make sense at all, okay? But if they lock you for a year, every day give you the newspaper, okay? Suppose you are very smart, you know, your brain is like a computer, you can parse, you can do this. After a year, you probably can recognize a lot of things inside, okay? Actually, I know there are some illegal immigrants, they know nothing about English, they smuggling into US, they got no teacher. But after many years, they actually figure out, right? They can speak a pretty good English. It simply says, you know the pattern. You got to keep posing by those newspapers. You figure out, you know, the patterns. The pattern is very important. Okay. Now we look at one thing is co-location mining. Co-location mining means you actually will try to find some redundancy. They found these things getting together should form a good phrase, they co-located. Just give a simple example, okay? For example, you say the tea is, suppose the tea is pretty strong, you say strong tea. You never say powerful tea. You never say thick tea, okay? Even look a little darker, okay? So that simply say you have co-location pattern, people are saying it. The same thing like this laptop, you never say this is a strong computer. You say this one is a powerful computer. So they have different way to do co-location. But this co-location redundancy actually will give you a very good hint, signal, for you to find this pattern mining. You can get a more significant pattern, more interesting one. So the general idea is you get a raw corpus, which is many, many documents. Then you do sentence segmentation, you do tokenization, you do stop word remover. A very important thing actually is frequent segment mining, okay? The interesting thing is a lot of people here in KDD in the past doing frequent pattern mining. Many people did not find very good applications. Actually, frequent pattern mining has very good application on the phrase mining and entity tagging and all of these things, okay? So then you can get an entity dimension identification, okay? So if you get large corpus like this, okay? You do mining or count frequent segments, you may get this counting, okay? What's the usage of this counting, okay? For example, you get international, you get airport, now you get an international airport, okay? Why international airport could be a good phrase? Actually, the general philosophy is you just look at your whole corpus. International may appear sometimes, airports may appear sometimes, but if you just base on, suppose this one occur 1/1,000 times, this one, this airport appear 1/1,000 times. By chance, these two things getting together should be 1/1,000,000. Simply says, in the documents, in your, you know, hundreds or thousand documents, they may appear only once, but actually you find it appear many times. That's not by chance, okay? It's almost destined. It must be a phrase, right? So the phrase mining, essentially, you just look at this one, we call it significant score. You actually can think about in statistics, you can think this one is a Z-score. Actually, the formula is very much like Z-score. It's just a little modification. It simply says, if you are three standard deviation away, you know this is almost like an outlier. And if this international airport appear 3 or 5, you know, standard deviation away. You know this is outlier in the sense they getting together is not easy, but now they do. That simply say they are very good phrase. Okay, so if you use this, you try to extract those key phrases, you may get a very good result. So you can segment the whole sentence. What's the point of segment the whole sentence? The reason is this, okay, you just give you a simple example. A lot of people are working on support vector machine. Suppose you get in a very large corpus, you get a vector machine, okay. But in the meantime, you also get support vector machine. So originally you think vector machine is a phrase. But later you may find when you go back to the corpora, you will find actually the support vector is more like a phrase. But once you segment itself, the vector machine will not count as an independent count. But sometimes you go down to the, you find support vector, but you don't have a support vector machine, but you do have support vector. Then support vector without support vector machine, they count as independent count. So you probably can see, in that sense, you go back to the sentence, you can get a real count of the one, okay? Now I just show you a very good example, okay? So you can see this is a significant score. You can think this is a Z score if you're not quite sure what is significant score. But anybody knows if Z score is greater than 3, you know, like this, according to our standard deviation, like normal or Gaussian distribution, okay? So you know anything greater than 3 standard deviation away, the chance is 0.03%. It's very rare. Simply say you can think they all are, but in that case they do happen, they form a good phrase, okay? Then we just give you a simple run. You probably see what's the trick of our method. The method we use actually was Ahmed developed one called Top Mind without anything, without anybody trying, okay? You don't need training, but you need a large corpus. You can count them. You can get a frequency. Suppose you count many such titles in DBRP, okay? What you find, like this is just one title. For this title, you find support vector. If you calculate this significant score, you think it's Z score. This one is 12. 12 means they really, really glue together. You know, by chance, they should have no way to have such high frequency, but you do have support vector get together. So in the dendrogram, you will say this one tightly get together, this must be a phrase, okay? Then you calculate support vector getting together with the machines. You find this alpha is 8. Simply says this one still tied together very tightly, okay? Much better than by chance, okay? Then you will say support vector machine is a good phrase. So that's a way you just counting them, you get phrase mining, okay? But what's the point of segmentation? I can give you this, okay? Suppose in the document you have many things like a selection for, okay? Remember, if you really go down to the research article, selection for actually it's pretty popular. But if you find a feature selection, okay, it's tightly bound, their alpha score is much higher, then you will say feature selection get together, the chance is higher, I would say feature selection is a phrase. Once feature selection is a phrase, selection for in this particular case will discount, unless you get a feature selection for so many times. Actually, you go down the real documents, selection for may be many, but the feature selection for is not so many, okay? In that sense, you actually find this, you will discount this selection for. Okay, you won't count in this particular segmentation, you won't count as a support to your selection for. Okay. So with this one, then you will be able to find a marker blanket is a phrase, feature selection is a phrase, support vector machine is a phrase. You segment this one into 3 phrases. Remember, this one has no training, nothing. Okay. You will be able to find these 3 phrases like this very nicely. So it's very simple, and it's very, very fast. I probably, later I will show you. So fast, it's amazingly, Ahmed actually tried the not DBRP phrases. He went to an Army research lab, which we collaborate with them with. They give us the medical manual for the people in Afghanistan. Half written in English, half written in Darcy, which is Afghanistan language, which I know nothing about it. But we tried English, okay? The manual is about 200 pages, okay? And
without anybody trained, without any seed. Okay, he just goes through using this method, plowing through during a lunch break. He just showed to a few army researchers, takes less than 2 seconds, generates thousands of very nice phrases like these. Okay, simply says it's very, very fast. It's just a simple frequent pattern mining. You can think in that way. But it generates all the very quality one using this simple statistics. Okay. And if you can integrate with the grammar, that one we did not use any grammar, but you put a little grammar inside. For example, you can see this is Dallas for towards International Airport. Use a little grammar inside, you will generate very good phrases, but you won't get a Western Oklahoma there, okay? But you may get a Wednesday afternoon, Tuesday afternoon, you get a Dallas Force International Airport as a phrase, because you take the previous phrase with mining, you do a little like this entity grammar, you will be able to recognize, because West Oklahoma is not so frequent, okay? But Oklahoma is. But Dallas Force, Fort Worth International Airport, the whole thing getting together these score, this significant score is pretty high. That's why so long you still get it as one phrase. But so short, like West Oklahoma, you will not get it as a phrase, but Oklahoma is. So this frequent pattern mining integrated with the entity grammar becomes very powerful. Okay. So you probably see you can get into this part. This is using POS tagging plus corpus relevant phrase. That means different corpus, you get different phrases. Just give you a simple example. We still go back to support vector machine, okay? I just mentioned a vector machine won't be a phrase, but it's for this machine learning or DBRP corpus. But if you go to a computer architecture corpus, okay, they may have vector machine. Where below is a very good phrase, but support vector machine may not, okay? Because they're discussing vector machines. Okay? So you go to that corpus, you will find a vector machine is a good phrase, but support vector machine is not. Okay, that's based on your corpus, not based on anybody training or anything. Okay, so with this method, we can redo the topic modeling. Remember, there are lots of people doing topic modeling. Many, many people doing topic modeling using unigrams. That means you using single phrase, you get topics. But if you even read a lot of the topic modeling results, unigrams, in many cases, you will not even get support vector machine in the same topic, because the machine likely is mechanical engineering. Vector could be, you know, like linear algebra. Support maybe even politics, like a presidential election. How could support vector machine three things put in the same topic? Okay, then you will never get support vector machine. Okay, so but here you probably see we instead of doing single unigram topic modeling, we do whole phrase topic modeling. That means we first grab those phrases. Then in this topic model, you perceive those phrases, they link together, we put a tie there. That means you recognize the individual unigram, but you also recognize the tie of them as a phrase. Okay. Then you do this phrase-based RDA. Okay, that's a phrase-based RDA is what we developed in TopMind. Okay. Then instead of thinking your document as bagged of words, we are thinking your document is bagged of phrases. Okay. Then you do the mining, you get a far better results. This one I just show you in 1989. Okay, we took Associated Press news. This AP news we have a zero labeling. That means we do not do any kind of training. We just feed this whole news into our top mind system. Okay. Then the top mind, even the unigram, because we do unigram and gram together, even the unigram actually improves quite a lot. Okay. Not to say if you look at the n-grams, actually if you look at everyone, like this one is more like environmental things, okay. Nuclear power, natural gas, you know, acid rain. This one is about Roman Catholic. This one is about a Middle East conflict.
this is about a present Bush, because 89 was the old Bush, okay, the elder Bush, okay. And this is the health care, all these things. You probably see they really make a very good topics. Of course, there are hundreds of such topics, but they all make sense. Okay, we tried Yelp, I won't show you this. Yelp is also make a lot of sense. But even you look at the time actually got a substantial reduced time comparing to like a PDRBA. This one is also using free space to try to LDA. You probably can see we do this one for the DBRP titer, we do in 2.45 hours. They do that, this is projected that many days. You can see turbo topic is that many days. But the only thing we are close is LDA. But that previous LDA, they do unigram. We do the free-spaced, so the result is different. If you look at this result, of course, you can see the whole paper. We have lots of performance studies. This one just show you the phrase quality. Use Z score. You probably can see this top mine, that's our method, get a pretty high phrase, high quality. But the next one is turbo. You can see the turbo is lower, but it's the next one. This is based on ACR data and 20 conference data. But even turbo, you look at turbo, they took more than 30 days to get this. Okay, they simply say it's very slow. Okay, so this is fast, but the quality is good. Okay, but if you add POS tagging, okay, you do the constraint-based POS tagging, then you add to top mine, you get a much better quality of the phrases. I probably can show you the result. Okay. This is top mine without using POS constraints, without using part of speech. This column is using part of speech. Then you see this topic. This is we mine the Yelp data. Okay. Yelp, they are very short. Okay. Sometimes they repeat. Just give you this. Food was good or pretty good, those things. They repeat a lot because they do review. They like the food. They say food was good. Okay. But if you just use top mind, just without anybody trained, you do not use part of speech, you will think this one is a phrase. Actually, because it's frequent, they get together very frequently, you get a phrase. But this one is a sentence. You use part of speech tagging, you will get rid of those things. Okay. Then you can see all these make a lot of sense. Okay. These are the phrases about food. This is about Chinese food. Or Eastern food like Thai food or these. This one is about a grocery store. You can see originally you can see prices are reasonable. These are not good. Okay. But you add part speech tagging, immediately become much better quality. Remember this one has no training at all. Okay. Now we get another thing is weakly and distantly supervised mention detection. The reason we emphasize this, we first use this, we say, even unsupervised, we don't add anything. We actually got something pretty good already. But that doesn't mean we don't want any training, because sometimes you do have good labels. For example, you have some knowledge base available, like a Wikipedia. Why don't use it? Okay. You get a little additional help, you get even better quality. Okay. So that's the reason we go down to the third one. We try to get this. Okay. Actually, before us, there are some thinking, there are some previous study on this already. That means people may want to use any kind of additional signal. For example, you may use some cue on the entity dimension. The full supervision, usually you do the tagging, curation on the concrete documents, is too expensive. But if you use a remote one, weak one, for example, remote one means I just give you a wiki or give you freebase instead of I do anything. The weekly supervised one means I just give you may or may not directly related to this particular set of documents, but I actually just mark, not mark in the document itself. I just mark a few phrases. Suppose I just judge this phrase is good, this phrase is not so good. I just judge in this way, that form weekly supervised method. Okay. So there are some semi-supervised chunking with structured learning, but due to the time, I probably will not get into detail. This is the previous work.
And there are some people explore dictionaries in the mention detection. That means you may extract some medical dictionary, you know, like you go to a particular manufacturer like Boeing, they have a dictionary. They have a large dictionary you can use. You can use this using semi-Markov model. They get a better result, okay. I mainly want to emphasize is the newest work we got. This one actually just published 2 months ago in June, actually in Melbourne. That's a Sigma conference this year. All the conferences come to Australia, okay. Actually, CIKM will be in Australia as well. So then in Melbourne, we published this work. This work actually in the same month, surprisingly to us, is Yelp data challenge, dataset challenge. They give this paper grand prize of this year. Okay, they give $5,000 as an award. I just say just to distribute among students because me and Shuwan, we got a full salary already. we give it to Jialu, Xiang, you know, let them to distribute. But anyway, it's a big honor. But why Yelp is so interested in this work? Because we actually take Yelp data as a typical data set as well. We take Yelp, we take Twits, we take New York Times, take all these popular data sets. But we show we use a little supervision. For the supervision, how much supervision we use, in this Sigma publication that time, we say you can get a gigabytes or multiple gigabytes corpus, but we only need 300 labels. That means we generate phrases. Human can judge these phrases, whether they are good phrases, they are bad phrases. That means you get a yes or no. Okay, you get this simple label, just 300 labels. Then that's it. Then you can generate very high quality, better quality than the top man. Okay. People may later they say, I still don't want 300 labels. What about you do not label at all, but use the distant training? So-called distant training means you give us wiki or give us freebase. We don't give you any label. Actually, right after Sigma, our group actually did a further study, not using any label, but just use distant training. That means use a freebase, those kind of things. And it still generates very high quality, same quality if it's not better, okay, the sentence. So the general idea is you use raw corpus, you use a little training, okay. Then instead of you generate quality phrase that time, you also kick up some classify. That means instead of just using the frequency, frequent pattern, the frequency, you use a little classification process as well. Then we also use segmentation. Then we take this, take into loop. That means we do segmentation, we go back to the classifier again. Okay, I show you the free flow graph you probably can see. The general philosophy is this, okay, we first take the corpus, okay. Then we do frequent pattern mining. Okay, this part is interesting, the frequent pattern mining becomes quite alive in our study. Then we get candidates, we extract the features, we feed this feature using those labels. This label of the compounds, that means we do have 300 labels here. We use them as a classifier. We extract the real feature. We build a reasonably good classifier. And then we go back to the phrase, to the corpus. We do phrasal segmentation. That means we go to the corpus, we mark whether they're a good one. Then we do this one in a loop. Okay, we do this one in one loop. After this, that means we redo classification, then redo segmentation, then we output the phrase. That phrase actually is pretty high quality. Okay. So how to judge the quality? Okay, we work out, actually, Chi Wang in his thesis and Marina Danilevsky, they too actually working together. They work out these four standards. We actually, both Ahmed and Jialu, they actually use these four standards. One called popularity, one called concordance, one called informativeness, one called completeness. Okay. What is popularity? Popularity means if you judge two phrases, okay, suppose one is information retrieval, another is cross-language information retrieval. Okay. Obviously, you can see the cross-language information retrieval is much less frequent than information retrieval. In that sense, information retrieval is more popular,
So this one should rank higher. Okay, those, so the judge the differences, you judge based on popularity. Another one is judge based on concordance. Concordance means they really getting together like a phrase. Okay. For example, we can see powerful T, you will never see it, but you see lots of strong T. Okay. But active learning, you see quite popular. But learning classification, even they are very similar. Sometimes they do get together, but actually they are not natural. You use frequency, you can easily see active learning getting together, you get a much higher significance score. But learning classification, you get a much lower significance score. That's the reason, based on concordance, this one, active learning should be the choice. Okay. The third one is informativeness. Simply says, you use something really like this phrase you generated, like this paper. Actually, it's like a stop word. You can think this is a stop phrase. They generate anywhere in all the papers. Okay, this even is very popular, but they are not discriminative, not informative. Okay. Like in this topic, you generate this paper. You go to another topic, they still have this paper. Okay, so it's not discriminative, you will remove them. The fourth one is completeness. Simply says you get a vector machine, you get a support vector machine. Suppose in your corpus, any time appear a vector machine, almost you got support vector machine. You get very similar frequency. Then you will say support vector machine is a real one, it's complete one. The vector machine is incomplete. So this is more like in frequent pattern mining, you have a close frequent pattern mining. This is more like a closed, even if it's not 100 close. It's, as long as the frequency is similar, you will count it. Okay. Then we actually use this, we do pattern mining, first mine frequent pattern, but we think we want this K to be reasonably small, because in reality, you get a very, very long one, it's not really a phrase. So we actually say, we set up a K usually is no more than 6. Okay, like you get a Fort, Dallas Fort Worth International Airport. That's it, right? You get even more, you probably will not really get a very good phrase. And then we based on the, instead of a raw score, we first use this, get a raw score, but then we actually rectify them, okay? Rectify them, you probably see, you look at the concordance. Like a support vector machine, unfortunately for the, if you work on the PowerPoint, you know this one is on the Apple machine. They actually, this is the subscript they write down like this, okay? You just know what it is. That's it, right. But anyway, you get, this is left part, this is right part. But you see they are not randomly getting together, they are very tightly get together. You can use this log value, this is like an entropy kind of thing, but you can use point-wise mutual information, or you can use KR divergence, you can use many other ones. But anyway, you can see whether they get together frequently. You, based on this, calculate the concordance. For informativeness, you base on whether this one essentially is the IDF. You see whether it also appear in other documents. If they are appearing in other documents, too many, you will think this is like a stop words. You are going to figure them out, okay? Then we build a classifier. Essentially, our labor is this. Suppose you get a support vector machine, you say, this one's a good one. You say, the experiment shows. You say, this is not a good phrase. What you need is just to say, this is one, this is zero, or this is yes, this is no. You take this, we usually get gigabytes corpus, you only need around 300 labels, okay? This is, of course, why 300? This is based on our experiments, okay? But a small number of labels is good enough, but too small, maybe you miss something. And you based on this, you construct a classifier, and we use random forest as a classifier, okay? Then you probably can see, you go back to segmentation. Why segmentation is important? You probably can see here. You may think vector machine is a phrase, because you see vector machine is quite popular. Okay. Of course, the support vector machine is even more popular. But why you don't get vector machine together as a phrase? Because you go back, you will see, you get a feature vector, you get machine learning, okay? these are, you go back, you say feature vector actually count title, you go back, you say this one is a phrase, this one is phrase, then the vector machine will never count as a phrase here. That means, to that extent, vector machine really getting together is very rare in the machine learning literature. Even you do see this, they don't count. Okay, so then you see support vector machine is frequent, support vector maybe, but vector machine, even that one appears, you will not count as a true frequency, okay? Because it's shared by feature vector and machine learning. Okay, so that means we actually get a frequency, we get a rectified frequency. This is, of course, it's a fake one. In the real life, it's not so neat. But what you got is, like the vector machine, originally you say 150 as a support. When you get rid of these, you may find only 6. So then you will say this one actually is not a really good phrase, because support vector machine get 80, this gets 6. The support vector machine should be the real phrase instead of vector machine, okay? Then we take segmentation, we go back to look at a probability in corpus, and also we do not want a very big length, like we say length 6 is good, the longer length we get certain penalty, okay? Then you see we get a loop on this, you get a classification, you get a phrasal segmentation. You go back to classification again, you do phrasal segmentation again. After you go around this loop, you actually we tried, you loop many times, it doesn't really help. Okay, just take you more longer time. But you do one round from sec phrase, we say you do one more round, we get a sec phrase plus. And you will see this sec phrase plus really give you very high performance. Okay. Then I will show you the experiments. The experiments essentially is we use NLP chunking as example to compare. They use TF-IDF and C value as a major measure. We are going to compare both of the methods. And we also compare with a DTS method. A DTS actually last year got a CKDD dissertation award runner-up. He also got a Sigma dissertation award, and he is our group's new faculty. He just got a Stanford dissertation award as well. He joined UIC as a young assistant professor. But he did have one paper on the unsupervised raw frequency-based method. We compare with his method as well. And we also compare the VRDB 2015 top mine. Remember, this comparison may not be very fair because these, they have no supervision at all. And our method, we do have supervision. But we do want to see the quality of the final phrase. Okay, that's the reason we still put them into comparison. We also compare the supervised method. Okay, so then we use the real data sets like DBRP and Yelp. They have millions of documents. They have millions, tens of millions or 100 millions of words. We only give 300 labels because the labor effort is very small. Okay, then we look at other methods. But we better show you the curves, okay? You see the curves is a precision recall curves, okay? This part is recall, this part is precision. You don't want to get a too high recall because you want to get everything, the precision will go down. But we compare with all the comparison methods, you probably see the black one is sec phrase plus this one, okay? Comparing to all those methods, this one actually is always on the top, okay? Of course, we just say top mine is not so high, but remember, top mine has no supervision at all, okay? So this comparison, we do not want to demote top mine because top mine got no labor at all, but still got pretty good. Comparing to some labor method was still good. But with labor, we do see you increase the performance quite a lot. And also the method is linearly scalable. In a sense, you keep getting more and more data. Actually, it's scalable in the linear way. Okay. But a more exciting, very exciting thing is because we use, remember we use frequent pattern, we do not really use the language feature like parsing, like you know, the full parsing, anything. it works the same method, okay, the method. It works for not only English, it works for other languages as well, okay. Since our group has lots of people who know Chinese, we try Chinese as well, but Ahmed does know Arabic, okay, we try Arabic as well. Actually, this one we tried is, you probably see the Chinese is use Chinese Wikipedia. The Arabic one we use Quran, which is like the Bible of Islam, okay. So we use this, very popular ones, but you probably see the Chinese one, we did get a very good phrase. You can, this is even ranked 1,000, this one is 99,000 something. Even that many phrases were generated. You still see these are pretty good Chinese phrases. Remember, Chinese actually is pretty hard because they don't have a space in the words. Okay, everything is consecutive. There is no space at all. Okay, but you have the parsing and finally generate pretty good, like this is a pretty long one, right? But you still generate very good Chinese phrases, and they do make sense. Okay. The Arabic one, you probably see, this is, remember the Arabic, actually they go from right to left. Okay, actually in PowerPoint, in the Microsoft one, we printed here. Somehow the Apple probably smart or overly smart, they actually put it right here. But you know, then some people in Arabic say that's right because they do write, they do read it this way. Okay, so they put it. But anyway, you probably see, this one means those who disbelieve, or this one is in the name of God or something. So it's a pretty long phrase. You still can clearly recognize. Even I do not know anything about Arabic, but the people say it does make sense. Okay, then you look at the English one. Okay, you look at English one because we can judge whether they are really good quality phrases. But we use SIGMOD as a, because it was published in SIGMOD, we use SIGMOD as a corpus, but we did use KDD as well. You can see this is KDD. Okay, we use SIGMOD, we show this sec phrase plus generate this one, this is non-phrase chunking, generate this one. Then you look at the sec phrase generated. These red ones is we generated, non-phrase chunker did not generate it, okay. These blue ones means non-phrase chunker generated, we did not generate it. But if you look at this, this is a sigma about database. You can see we have a relational data, junk query, high dimensional data, two-phase locking. If you work on relational database, you know these are critical terms we generated. But surprisingly, non-phrase chunker cannot get even two-phase locking. But on the other hand, if you look at what they generate, the large volume, efficient implementation, large collection, important issue. This is almost for any research papers. So they are not really that informative in for this particular corpus. So you probably can see. Even you look at KDD, you probably see we have time series, gene expression data, frequent subgraph, categorical attributes. These are very important for DataMine. But what they got is important problem, efficient way, or a small set. This is not really, really that meaningful. Even you look at, take a particular phrase, you say, what's a similar phrases? Our method can give you similar phrases. For example, you look at data mining, we get knowledge discovery, text mining, like you know, machine learning. Or you get like a noodle, you get like a ramen, noodle soup, rice noodle, egg noodle, pasta. These are all noodle-like, right? But if you look at the non-phrase chunking, you actually get something like a stir-fry fish ball. They are not noodle at all, right? So you probably can see it's pretty sensitive you can get this. So that's the part I finished. Sorry, I took a little longer time than expected. I think we have 30 minutes break. What about we get 25 minutes? We resume at 11 o'clock. Okay, thank you.
by saying that this is more difficult than the because you need to like eventually distribute these categories into different categories, say, let's say there's stoppers, one label and one, but there's some different like support by the label and one word. So if you only focus on the difficult word, let's say support by the label, so you should have others.
It's easy to raise the rate of
all I see. If you put in zero labels, for this
process,
that should be discounted.
You should write
the biggest
one. Yeah, on this, on top of
that's
this
the biggest integration we want to introduce a little bit of this different integration. Trying to discount those phrases that not make it sense to people, but make sense to the algorithm.
Yeah.
That's very true.
Actually, it's interesting.
That's right. But actually, I'm working with the group that looks at complaint data.
Oh.
And
the customer complaint.
Yeah, when they like
actually,
they get to the website and they say,
I
hate this flight.
I hate this flight.
I hate this flight.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, there's a mixture. There's like the complaints and confidence. Like, sometimes you get people who are playing and say, so one of the projects I'm interested in is identifying complaint compliments and if we can tell which employee it is, right? So
you want to identify the employee.
Right. And it's very difficult unless they give some clues to what name, so it's either surname or first name.
I was thinking
you should all together figure out